is Sherry Wei, and I'm the General Manager of EnGenius Europe. Welcome to our Visualizer Network Cloud Launch event and Partner Summit. It is our great pleasure today to introduce to you our latest technology and our upcoming cloud solution. On top of that, to celebrate our 20 years anniversary together with you. Years ago, when Wi-Fi was introduced to the market, EnGenius was one of the very first brands that were able to provide Wi-Fi devices. We were very well known for our reliable and robust products. However, with the popularity of mobile devices and also the increasing demand of Wi-Fi connection, we understand that just providing hardware is not sufficient. This is why in 2015, we launched our end-to-end managed solution. This software-defined solution enables the users to plan, deploy, and manage the network at their fingertips, using the easiest way to configure and define the Wi-Fi the way they want. This year, in the 20 years of our EnGenius brand, we are very proud to announce to you that EnGenius has made one step ahead, another step further, to be the very first brand to launch the latest 11x technology and the serverless AI-driven cloud solution. So in today's presentation, we will present to you the advantages and also the benefits of these latest technology and solution. Before we move to the presentation, I would like to express our appreciation to our special speaker, Mr. Simon Brandt from our strategic partner Qualcomm. Thank you, Simon, for coming all the way to support us and to share with us the knowledge of 11AX. Also, thanks to our technology partners who are here today, including OSCOM, Cloud4Y, NDN, HRT, and RStore. Thank you for choosing EnGenius to be your Wi-Fi partner. Lastly, and most importantly, I would like to thank all of you to be here today, and your support throughout the years is our key to success. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy today. Thank you.
So, welcome in Italy for no Italian partner, e beh, grazie a tutti invece gli altri italiani per essere venuti. Questo è il nostro primo evento europeo di EnGenius. Vi ringrazio di essere venuti perché appunto è grazie a voi che siamo qua. Il fatto che siamo in Italia non è un caso, è nuovamente la prima country per fatturato e questo devo dire grazie a voi. Allora, oggi finalmente dopo tanto tempo presenteremo la piattaforma cloud che tutti noi aspettavamo da tempo e in più appunto, come diceva prima Sherry, il lancio per la piattaforma Wi-Fi 6 o 11AX. E niente, cosa dire, ci sarà adesso la presentazione da parte di Qualcomm, che tutti voi conoscete come leader mondiale per quanto riguarda la parte di semiconduttori, e successivamente ci sarà un coffee break in cui vi invito appunto di fermarvi nella sala demo qua a fianco, in cui sia noi che i nostri partner tecnologici vi mostreremo appunto le ultime tecnologie relative applicazioni. E poi come ultima cosa appunto, se avete domande o quant'altro, ci sarà anche durante il pranzo. Io adesso poi passo il microfono ad Amanda che farà l'introduzione appunto alla parte di Qualcomm. Per qualsiasi cosa, sia io che Alessandro siamo disponibili di là. E vabbè, prima di partire comunque ringrazio i nostri partner che hanno premesso di essere qua. Li dico in ordine alfabetico, quindi ESCOM, Cloud4Y, Endian, HRT e anche RStore che ci ha fornito del materiale per organizzare l'evento. Grazie a tutti e buon inizio dell'evento. Grazie.
So first up today, I want to welcome Mr. Simon Brandt, the Senior Product Director with Qualcomm, and he'll be reviewing the advantages and the benefits of 11AX technology.
Okay, hi, welcome. My name is Simon Brandt, and I'm going to show a few slides to introduce the 11AX technology and how it benefits the use case. So I want to start with this first slide that shows, let's say, the use cases for which 11AX has been developed. So when the standard was made, The goal was to reach a factor 4 higher throughput and very dense environment. So let's run through a few of those dense environments. For example, in high-rise apartment buildings, imagine that you have access points installed by the carriers very close together, and these access points operate at a certain band, a certain frequency. These cannot be controlled, and you know, different access points may operate at the same frequency, and there will be collisions happening. And I walked through some of the technologies how that can help. LFNX can help improve the collision management. Another use case is the enterprise and large venues use case, where imagine you have many clients, many stations connected to a single access point. In the past, we had maybe 20, 30 access points. Stations connected to access points. But these days, maybe 100, maybe 200, maybe 500 stations will be connected to a single access point. So there are technologies developed like OFDMA and multi-user MIMO that will manage the traffic flows for these high number of stations connected to a single access point. Really well, and I'll go through some of these technologies as well in this presentation. 11EX is also improved for home use. For example, in home use or maybe hotspot use, imagine that you want to increase the range, single access point going as far as possible. There are technologies in 11EX that help increase the range, the coverage in home as well. Another use case is, for example, in universities. Imagine an access point that is installed in a classroom where all the students have to kind of connect to the access point, have to make a certain test, and the connection to all those different users have to be equal. They need to be equal opportunity to all the students that are connecting to the access point. So there are certain mechanisms built in the built in 11EX technology, so that the quality of service, the guarantee of packets distributed over the stations is manageable. It's not based on random processes. It is very much deterministic. Okay, so let's move to the next slide. Okay, so this slide gives you an impression of the vision of the very dense environments. So in apartment buildings, imagine the big dots representing the access points. There are many of those access points in a very dense environment, so they have to be managed well. Each of those access points is connecting to not only phones, not only tablets, but laptops, IoT devices. There is a special kind of feature built in 11EX that make battery-operated devices, IoT devices, work at really low power. We call that target wait time. I'll explain that later. So all these features are available in 11EX. So at a high level, 11EX, Wi-Fi 6, also referred to in the Wi-Fi Alliance, will give you the factor 4 higher throughput capacity. It will increase the efficiency. There are technologies on symbol length that I will explain to get much better efficiency of the of the data throughput, and we talked about improved coverage as well. So this slide shows the 8 technology options that are available in 11EX that help improve the use cases that I explained. So the first technology is multi-user MIMO. 11AC today, or 11M today, is based on MIMO. So that means that you have multiple antennas on the AP, you have multiple antennas on the station, and those multiple antennas carry traffic And the aggregate, the more antennas, the more let's say, the more capacity can be transferred from the AV to the station. With multi-user MIMO, a new feature is introduced. By increasing more antennas on the access point, there is more capacity available at the AP to wirelessly distribute into the to the stations. But stations do not have a lot of antennas; they have only one antenna. So what multi-user MIMO is doing, it will virtually group the several stations, several mobile phones, or tablets, or laptops together. Let's assume that each station has one antenna. So if you group as multi-user MIMO those four stations in one, you send them a trigger. So they act like a 4x4 virtual station, and with the four antennas on the AP, you're able to have the full capacity, even if the stations have only one or two antennas. So multi-user MIMO is increasing the capacity, even to antennas, stations with fewer antennas. Another technology that is introduced is OFDMA. So OFDMA is a technology where the spectrum, that is typically 80 megahertz wide, is split into smaller chunks of 2 megahertz. We call that research units, and small packets will be allocated to those small research units and distributed through the, let's say, to multiple stations at the same time. I'll explain in a few slides how that works. So, in summary, OFDMA will help improve small packet communication, and multi-user MIMO will help large packet communication to the stations. Another technology that is introduced is uplink resource scheduling. Today, the way Wi-Fi works is you have an access point that transmits information to the stations in the downlink direction, and stations that need to transmit information in the uplink direction, they have to grab the time slot through a contention mechanism, CCA. And that there will be contention, there will be back off, and there will be retries, and that gives inefficiency, especially if you have 100 or 200 stations all trying to connect to the AP. So what 11EX is introducing is that the stations are quiet and will wait for a trigger to be sent by the access point, and only then the communication will happen in the uplink. So that means that both the downlink and the uplink data communication is managed, and in that way the collisions are far less, and the quality of service is improved quite a bit. You can imagine if you have latency sensitive applications, for example enterprise voice, if you have a voice over IP phone, if voice packets have to be guaranteed in both downlink and uplink, this scheduling mechanism will help improve that use case. So imagine if you have an office space with maybe 10, 20, 100 voice over IP phones, 11EX will guarantee the quality of the voice much better than the legacy technologies like 11N, 11AC. Another technology feature that is introduced is the long symbol. In 11AC, imagine that the payload, so imagine the time axis over here, the payload is in the light gray box, at the AC, and then the blue area is so-called guard band. There is no information transmitted in there. So if you concatenate these packets, there is inefficiency every time there is a blue bar, and then data is communicated, and that continues like this. In 11EX, the redundancy part is pretty small, and all this time can be used for data communication. So that gives better efficiency. So the time is better used with the introduction of the long of the main symbol. Another technology that is introduced is 1024 QAM. So this is the modulation technique. 11AC today is only modulating up to 256 QAM. That gives 8 bits per second per hertz. With 1024 QAM, you go to 10 bits per second per hertz. That gives you a 25% throughput improvement. That throughput improvement is typically possible if, let's say, at short distance. So if you are within, let's say, 10 meter from the access point, you will be able to take benefit of the higher order modulation. So typically in room, you can expect a 25% higher throughput rate because of the introduction of 1024 QAM. Another feature, as I already explained to you, in the hotspot case, in the home case, you want to really increase your range, your coverage. There is a feature that's called extended range that is increasing the preamble and is duplicating some of the data to get a 3 dB extension of the coverage. I expect this feature to be very well used in home and hotspot environments. 11AX is also is defined in both 2.4 and 5 and the future 6 GHz band. 11AC is a technology that's only defined for 5 GHz. It is proprietary deployed in 2.4 GHz as well, but interoperability is not always guaranteed. With the introduction of 11AX, the 11AX technology, all those technology enhancements will be tested by the Wi-Fi Alliance in both bands, so that we now guarantee high performance, high quality IoT for all the bands. There is also a feature called BSS Caller. I'll explain it in another slide. So the fact that BSS Caller does, imagine you want to communicate to an access point that is here on the left, and there is a neighbor access point that is kind of disturbing or kind of trying to get the same time slots. With a coloring scheme, the communication is clear whether the station communicates to either this AP or that AP, and that coloring aspect also help improve the efficiency in very dense environments. Okay, so this is the high-level overview of the 11AX technology introduction. I spoke already about OFDMA and multi-user MIMO. In this slide, I indicate in a simplified form what will be the benefit for the different use cases. So let's start with OFDMA. So if an access point, in this example, needs to communicate to stations that are doing small packet communication. So think about, we talked about voice, we talked about gaming, so maybe some cloud services. The introduction of the product today with EnGenius is that there is a cloud component, so there is a lot of control messages going to let's say to the cloud server. So small messages will be communicated in the following form. Imagine this track to represent an 80 megahertz signal. Assume an 80 megahertz packet to go from the AP to the station. If this is 80 megahertz, what OFDMA is doing, it chops the spectrum up in small chunks of 2 megahertz. These small chunks of 2 megahertz can be extended to, let's say, 10 megahertz, another 50 megahertz, and all the way up to 80 megahertz to fill it completely. And in one packet transmission, this information will go to, let's say, this laptop. This information will go to a cloud server, and maybe this part of the information is going to an IoT device, maybe a light bulb or a voice over IP device. So every time a truck goes to the other side, a PPDU, a packet is transmitted in 11AX, This is every 2 milliseconds. There is a packet going from the AP to the station, and in one transmission, all this information goes at once. While in 11AC or 11N, imagine that every time a packet is being transmitted, it has to go to one user. So if, for example, the packet load is small, then this will be empty. And there will be a lot of inefficiency. So by introducing OFDMA and having the small packets all grouped together, there is much more efficient communication for small packets in these use cases. In multi-user MIMO, what happens is imagine that you have a lot of data that has to be communicated from the access point to the stations. Imagine the full 80 megahertz bandwidth. There is so much data available in the access point that it can completely fill the truckload and transmit this at once. So imagine if there is one antenna on each device, then one truck represents the data that will go to one antenna. If there is another device with one antenna, then if you have, for example, a 4-antenna access point, then one antenna will carry the data of one truckload, and then the next antenna will contain the data of the next truckload, and will send it all at once to the stations. So in that way, you increase the capacity of the access point by multiplexing all those large chunks of data to the stations. So multi-user MIMO is increasing the capacity because you stack all those 80 megahertz spatial streams on top. The user will get its max throughput. So ideal for high bandwidth applications, cloud uploads, video streaming, a lot of high capacity data will be mapped onto multi-user MIMO, while the small packet, as I explained, voice and control map messages will be mapped into OFDMA. So two major technology improvements with the introduction of 11AX. So I made this slide to kind of illustrate how the long symbol will help. So I start by explaining that in the old 11B technology, a single carrier system. So imagine you are in a room, and in that room there are a lot of echoes happening. Maybe the walls is painted, there's not many curtains. So if you speak from A to B, you speak a certain language, a certain sentence. But that sentence will be reflecting to the walls, to the windows, to the floors, and arrive a little later, as an echo. So that means that if you try to listen to the sum of these signals, so the line of sight signal and then the echo signals, at some point you get the signal delayed, and that gives garbage. If you don't do the right things, it is difficult to decode the communication while echo is happening. So imagine that if you speak slower and you pause with every word, you say it is easier if you pause. Right? So every time you have a waiting time when you speak to the other side, it is easier to decode each word. It's easier. And the drawback, of course, is that the data communication happens when there is a word transmitted. But that the waiting time, the guard end, is when it's kind of wasted, right? It's only there to make sure that that echoes can be, can be handled properly. But this is the technology of the OFDM that is used since the introduction of 11A, so it's very old technology. But what 11AX is doing, it is increasing the efficiency based on this technology. So in 11AC, there is a so-called short symbol. So imagine every time a word is transmitted, every time a packet is transmitted, the symbol duration is 3.2 microseconds. That's fixed, defined by the standard. So then the waiting time in between the words is to make sure that the echoes can settle down and the delay spread is resolved. So we call that the guard band. So the guard band refers to the empty spaces. There are two different guard bands in 11AC. You can do that with an 0.4 or 0.8. So that creates an efficiency of either 89 or 80%, dependent on what guard band you choose. Imagine that the 0.8 microsecond guard band, so the kind of the longest possible in the standard, is typically chosen in outdoor environments where echoes come from a long distance. Imagine you have buildings with these glass windows, and for outdoor hotspot, you have those echoes coming all the way from the window back. So you need longer spread, which will reduce your efficiency, but at least you're able to properly decode the signal. Now, what 11EX is introducing, they're introducing a symbol duration, which is four times as long. So 12.8 microseconds from 3.2. So if you have a very long word, and then we have the same kind of waiting time, the standard allows this to be either 0.8, 1.6, or 3.2 microseconds. So if you pick the 3.2, you have this 80% of the time we can actually transmit data. The other is kind of redundant for the echo handling. But the smallest one is 0.8, that gives 94% of the airtime will actually be used for data communication. So you can see that there is about a 5% improvement for efficiency simply because of this feature. And that will help improve the efficiency. It's one of the elements that contribute to a factor four higher throughput. So then, why is there multi-user? You can imagine that if you go back to the system where we have now an 11EX system with a 12.8 microsecond symbol duration and this guard band, if you do small packets, if you have voice packets for, let's say, voice over IP, you have TCP IP packets, then you cannot fill the whole symbol. It's just a small payload and a very long symbol. So what OFDMA is doing, it as I explained to you earlier with the truck, you remember the small truck where we had all the small parts of the truck filled in with different data. We combine the data of multiple users, and we transmit that with that long symbol and the small guard band. This will give, we have in fact, let's say two benefits. You still have the long symbol to get a 94% efficiency, and you have the ability to fill the symbol completely with all the small packets to be able to have every bit of the airtime properly used. And there's no wasted time, no wasted capacity, all contributing to higher efficiency. So in this slide, I explain the same thing again, one more time. So in a typical use case, so for example, if you have a 2x2 access point, and you have a 2x2 mobile phone, it's a station device. By the way, what we see is that in 11EX, devices are typically two antenna. In 11EC, we saw a lot of one antenna devices. Today we expect that typical laptops that are 11EX compliant and phones will have two antenna reception. So what happens is that this is the 80 megahertz bandwidth I talked about as an example. If you have small packet communication, for example, to this phone, the 80 megahertz, so a subsection of the 80 megahertz is allocated with data for that will go to this gray phone. Another part of the spectrum will be filled with data that will go to another phone, and then there's many more. And then when the packet transmission actually happened, let's say all these small packets will go at once to the other side. So more efficient for small packets. I explained already the truck where we, so for example, if you have an 8 antenna access point, you have the most benefit from multi-user MIMO. So this gray phone now needs a lot of data, so the whole 80 megahertz and two antennas out of the 8 antennas will carry data for this gray phone, and other two antennas will carry data for the green phone, and so on. And it can be stacked up to the number of antennas that are on the AP. So if, for example, you have a 2x2 access point, you can stack up to two spatial streams. If you have a 4 antenna access point, you're able to stack up to 4 spatial streams, so you double the capacity. And if you would have 8, you can go over 8 to, let's say, 8 spaces. So that should be a consideration for your product definition, product choice. So here I show some data throughput rates for different technologies. So what I did over here, I show 4x4, 40 and 2.4 gigahertz. So in 2.4 gigahertz, the maximum communication is 40 megahertz wide. In 11AC, a certain throughput rate, the fire rate is 867 megabits per second, will be reached with the introduction of 1024 QAM, the long symbol, and other items. The throughput rate goes up by 39%. So the let's say the typical throughput rate for 11AX will be 39% higher. And then if you go away from the AP in rate versus range curve, at the far end point where the data communication is kind of ending, you will be seeing about the same distance. I will explain later how we can extend that. So if you want to communicate at a certain speed, for example, this is 1.1 gigabit fire rate, if you want to transmit at, let's say, 400 megabits per second to a user, you can see that because of the introduction of 11AX, there is a couple of dB range improvement for that throughput rate. So what we explain over here is that with the introduction of 11AX, the coverage is improved in the home. You can expect higher throughput rates at a further distance to the AP. If you you check the same thing in 80 megahertz, the max fire rate is 2.4 gigabit. So the UDP rate is typically about 80% or of that. For 11AC, where the throughput rate, the fire rate is 1.7 gigabit, you also expect to see that 39% throughput improvement, as well as the home coverage improvement, so that user that receives maybe 1 gigabit over here is able to receive that 1 gigabit throughput a couple of dB, so a couple meter further from the access point. And in 8x8, these numbers go up to almost 5 gigabit. So I spoke about a feature to increase the range. So the feature that is introduced in 11X is called the extended range feature. So what it does, so imagine a communication happening between the access point 11AC in this example to an 11AC client. So this is what we do today. So if imagine the time axis over here, there is a preamble, and then there is the payload here in red, and packets are sent in this form from the AP to the station. So in 11X, there is a special feature introduced that increases the power of the preamble 3 dB above the regulatory limit. But it is only during a very, very short time, so that means that the regulatory limit is still compliant to the regulatory limit. So the preamble, because of this 3 dB higher power, can be seen 3 dB further away. So you have that far away point extended a little bit. But it's only for the preamble. And what this extended range feature is doing, so imagine that there is data communication mapped onto the carriers of the symbol. With 11AX, that information is duplicated. So let's say we have 4 bits of information. Those 4 bits of information is duplicated. So we get another 3 dB improvement by duplicating the data. And in the standard, this is called preamble boost and dual subcarrier modulation. So the fact that the data is duplicated, so you give up half the bandwidth, but you can reach 3 dB further. Another powerful feature that will help extend the range. So in this example, I show one of the the elements, one of the use cases that can be improved with this OFDMA. So imagine that you have a 30 dBm access point, that is the max regulatory power. That power that is transmitted from the access point will reach to a further certain point. And if you have a station that also have a 30 dBm, so a 1 watt radio inside, it will be able to communicate in the uplink to make sure that there is communication possible in both downlink and uplink. So the furthest away happens with the smallest bandwidth to have the highest power spectrum density. So you have a 20 megahertz signal typically to get to that far away point, to get the furthest range in data communication. But now imagine that in the 11EX you have, let's take a mobile phone, a battery operated device. A battery operated device does not have a 30 dBm radio. That will drain the battery too much. It typically is 18 or 20 dBm. So that means that if you would imagine in the top picture that if you would have one phone that has an 18 dBm radio, it will be able to hear the AP, but it will not be able to communicate back into the uplink because it simply doesn't have the enough power in the power amplifier to reach that point. So what 11AX is introducing is that if you have, let's say, multiple stations, let's take four in this example. So let's assume the power of the PAs is a factor four less, so let's assume 24 dBm. So then what uplink OFDMA can do, it will concentrate the transmission of this one phone in 5 megahertz, in 1/4 of the bandwidth, which will give the same power spectrum density as if there would have been a 30 dBm radio. So if you then group four of those in this example, so 5 megahertz each, those four phones, they fill the complete 5 megahertz bandwidth, and they will transmit in the uplink as soon as the trigger is received from the AP. So the AP sends a trigger to those phones, and then all at the same time transmitting the uplink. And by playing this trick, you're able to have the same reach. You can then still act like if you would be a 30 dBm PA and have that same home coverage in the uplink. So very powerful feature in 11EX. Another feature is the BSS color, the spatial reuse. So I already explained in the use case slide at the beginning that the map, oh, too fast. I'll give you a peek of the other slides already, so we'll go back. So imagine that data communication has to happen between this station and this access point in the BSS. So if there is a neighbor AP operating in the similar frequency band, the signal strength may be so high that this access point will be waiting until this access point is ready, and then finally do the transmission to the to this device. That means that while this access point is waiting for this guy to be ready, there is a lot of unused time. It's a waste of time to kind of wait for the neighbor to be ready. So what is introduced in 11EX is if you have a packet, there is the preamble, then there is the payload. In the preamble, there will be a 6-bit random code, and that 6-bit random code gives a color, gives a signature to the AP. So that means that if these two devices are associated, they are in the same color. So they communicate with packets that have a 6-bit random code determined by the AP and station that is unique for that for this blue access point. And the 6-bit random code will be different for the yellow one. So that means that, for example, when a packet is transmitted by this access point to another device, they haven't shown, but let's assume there is a packet transmission happening, then the blue one can see from the 6-bit random code, oh, this packet is not for me. And then if the power level is lowered, it just decides to transmit over it. And that is a very powerful feature to increase the transmit opportunities, to increase the efficiency in very dense environment. So, known as spatial loop. Another technology that is introduced with 11x is a feature called target wake time. So target wake time is helping to reduce the power consumption of the connected devices. So I try to explain this with an access point communicating to the station. And in this example, I mentioned the timeline over here. The actual communication happens in these big yellow or orange boxes. And in the meantime, when there is no data communication happening between AP and station, there is a listen received, there is CCA, there is retries happening. So both AP and station will consume power, will consume the battery, kind of without any reason, because the actual data communication is happening here. This is only to manage the network, to figure out when the actual transmission has to happen. So what 11EX is introducing is there is an kind of an agreement between the access point and the station. And the AP is telling the station, you are allowed to transmit in these time slots. So there is a clock running here, there is a clock running here, and they know from each other exactly when the communication has to happen. So that means that in the meantime, this battery operated device, from the Wi-Fi perspective, can go to sleep, because it knows that there is no communication required. And then when the time arrives, when communication has to happen, the Wi-Fi radio of this battery operated device wakes up, transmits, and the AP will be ready at that moment in time to receive that packet, because there is this agreement between AP and station to to receive that packet. So there is no contention, there is no CCA mechanism happening. They will just very effectively communicate with the lowest possible battery power consumption. So 11EX will help reduce the power consumption of battery operated devices. This is a feature that can be very, very helpful for IoT devices. So imagine if you have very, very tiny, battery operated, a smoke detector or something else. So these batteries may have to operate for a year or 5 years. So by having this TWT, you're able to, maybe you can say every hour this device wakes up for a bit, does its communication, and the AP is ready to receive that packet. And then this tiny battery operated device is able to go back to sleep and use its battery for a very, very long time. So I often get a question, so what happens if you have both 11EX and 11AC devices happening at, communicating at the same time? So I made this, some people call me a complicated slide, so I'm trying to explain. So let's first look to this box over here. So there is an 11EX access point communicating to all kind of stations, 11EX stations, 11N stations, 11AC stations, maybe 11B stations. And there is data flow happens from, from the AP in the downlink direction. And there is also communication happening in the other direction. So the access point has the ability to look to all those flows and manage that properly. So here I made an illustration of, of how the communication happened. So let's first look to legacy 11AC. So the standard allows, this packet, so imagine the timeline in this direction. So imagine a packet that goes into the air that lasts typically 2 milliseconds. Imagine that this device is a 160 megahertz device. It can also be 80 or 40, doesn't matter, it's up to 160 in the standard. And let's assume the device has two antennas. Then I'm able to fill, let's say, this box with this data, this packets, with bits, for that one device. So all this colored kind of information will go from one access point to this one station. So if there is a lot of data that has to be communicated, 11AC will do well. It will fill the packet, it will transmit the data to this one device during 2 milliseconds. If you do OFDMA, I explained that the 80 megahertz, so this is the width of the spectrum, is split into small resource units, two megahertz each. And so you can fill in principle up to 40. The standard is doing it up to 37. You fill up to 37 small packets, and you fill it up to the number of antennas that specific station has. So, for example, this red box over here is two streams high. So there is two streams of information in this small resource unit that will go to an 11AX device. There may be another device at the same time that will receive another two spatial streams of data in 2 megahertz wide. If there is a one-by-one device, that specific RU, resource unit, will be filled up with only one stream. It will be packed together. And during these 2 milliseconds, this information will be sent at once. So you can imagine if you have, for example, voice packets that are very tiny, TCP/IP ACK packets or control packets, they will all be grouped together as miscellaneous and sent at once. Well, in the past, you had to do a 2 milliseconds or so, maybe a 1 millisecond transmission with a lot of empty space. So, very effective way of communicating small packets. So, if you do communication to 11AX devices that require a lot of data, so this is the cloud-based uploads or video transmission. So what you can do in this example, I assume that each of the 11AX stations has one antenna. So we fill up one antenna for the complete 2 milliseconds, for the complete 160 or 80 megahertz device. And then with the introduction of multi-user MIMO, we stack all those spatial streams on top to the maximum number of antennas on the AP. In the product that is introduced today, we stack up to 4. In a 4x4, we stack up to 2 for a 2x2 device. And a lot of data, a lot of capacity is transmitted in that PPD. 11AC has also multi-user MIMO capabilities. It is able to stack it up to 8 spatial stream according to the standard. The only difference is that you can distribute only up to 4 users. While 11AX is a finer granularity, it will distribute those 8 spatial stream up to 8 different users. So that's the main difference between 11AX and 11AC multi-user MIMO. So then in this slide, I kind of at a use case try to indicate how the access point is kind of choosing its modulation technique dependent on the type of flows that have to be communicated. So for example, if modifications, not necessarily modifications, have to happen, these are typically small, then OFDMA will be used, voice will be used with OFDMA small packets. Gaming, browsing, and then if you go to web-based services, then typically multi-user MIMO will be chosen because we expect the data packet to be the data content to be bigger, and then multi-user MIMO will better make use of the capacity. So this is just an illustration of how this is done. This is not accurate in terms of the actual size. We just want to give an indication that this. So this choice will have to be made by the access point. And Qualcomm is implementing software in the scheduler to make sure that the proper modulation technique is chosen for the typical flow or packet that has to transmit. So here I did some illustration of what I expect to happen over time. So what I did over here, I assumed, let's assume that year one is 2019 today. and we have only legacy devices connected today. So with legacy devices, we reach a certain speed, dependent on, let's say, on the access point. So when next year, 2020, the 11AX stations are going to be in the market, in this case, I assume 13 devices as an example to be communicated by the AP. And then, for example, a year later, we still have those 13 legacy stations. And we have now four, and this is over here, four 11AX stations. So the 11AX stations will be able to more effectively communicate the information with the introduction of OFDMA, with the introduction of multi-user MIMO and all the other 1024 QAM. So there, the data communication is happening. It will scale down the capacity of the legacy devices, but the aggregate capacity is going up. Let's say if this is maybe a total of 600 megabit, then we go to maybe 800 megabit over here. So even the legacy devices will benefit as well, because now there is a total of 17 devices that will be communicating data, and the 13 devices still have a big chunk of the capacity. So then over time, let's say 2, 3, 4 years out, when there is more 11AX devices, the aggregate capacity, in this example I have 26 connected devices, we're able to get almost twice the speed, and the amount of legacy devices is still there, but everyone will experience higher throughput. So ideal 4x4 or 8x8, effective 4 higher throughput can be achieved if you can stack all the way up to 8 spatial streams. So this is the slide that I have put in to indicate what the Qualcomm-based solution is offering. IPQ stands for Internet Processor Qualcomm. The 8074 series is bringing the 11AX technology that is used in the product today that is going to be introduced. So what we have done. So when I went through the technology presentation, there is a lot of decisions to be made. What type of modulation is best for what type of flow? We talk about small packets, we talk about big packets. So we have decided to integrate the networking engine and the Wi-Fi radio in one piece of silicon, in one SoC. By having the networking engine, so the Ethernet kind of networking part and the Wi-Fi part in one chip, we have the ability to see the flows coming in from the Ethernet in the product that EnGenius is introducing today. There is a cloud-based component where all those flows, all those Ethernet packets come in. They will be stored in a buffer in the chip, and then dependent on the type of information that's in the buffer, and dependent on the transmit opportunities that occur at a certain moment in time, the scheduler will pick the small packets altogether, transmits an OFDMA packet, and then it will, in the next transmit opportunity, take the larger packets in a multi-user MIMO. So it has the ability to really optimize the scheduler for, let's say, cloud-based based services by having that all in one. So highly integrated SoC for optimal scheduling of all those technologies that I explained. Of course, the chip will reach higher speed. We talk about 1024 QAM, we talk about the long symbol. All these elements will give higher capacity, higher throughput. Capacity up to factor 4 higher, we talked about it quite a bit. And the Intelligent Network Manager is the element I talked about, that we have the Ethernet and Wi-Fi in one, we have the scheduler having access to all those flows in the buffer to optimally use the that mechanism. So I want to give you a peek into what we see happening in the marketplace from a timeline perspective. The IEEE standard has defined the technology for 11EX. The Wi-Fi Alliance is preparing a certification program that we expect to happen. The launch will happen in August. That's the current plan. So that means that the product will be able to be certified starting August timeframe with the Wi-Fi 6 logo. So in enterprise, carrier, in retail, where our product is used, we expect to see the certified products to happen after August timeframe. There are products in the market already since 2018 based on the IPQ 80,000 series. Of course, they are pre-Wi-Fi 6 because the actual certification program is not there yet. But since 2018, the product is in the field and we have quite some experience with the technology already. From a station perspective, from phones and computer devices perspective, announcements have already been made. So the first pre-certified products are in the market since Q1 2019, so a few months ago. And of course, the certified phones will phones and tablets and devices will become available after August timeframe. I thought this was my last slide. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Simon.
Sorry, I didn't do this.
No. I thank you for your presence and your support. Thank you very much. Allora, how you perceive probably the power of our access point modify when temperature is set here, and we have some problem with air condition. For now, I want to make a short summarize in Italian for our Italian customer regarding this technology. Allora, vi riassumo brevemente. La tecnologia Wi-Fi 6, che è anche definita 802.11ax, è la più grande rivoluzione nel mondo del Wi-Fi degli ultimi 10 anni, perché mentre, anche se si parla di velocità, l'obiettivo è aumentare la velocità, ora l'obiettivo è fare in modo che tanti dispositivi assieme si connettano permettendo il funzionamento della rete, perché il mondo è cambiato. Pomeriggio vi farò vedere qualche slide riguardo a quello che succederà, però siamo passati da un mondo dove in un hotel, ad esempio come questo, c'erano solo 5 anni fa un dispositivo Wi-Fi, se andava bene ogni stanza, ogni due, ha invece situazioni in cui c'è un'altissima densità di dispositivi. Il Wi-Fi non è nato per quello, ma lo sta diventando. Il Wi-Fi 6 è una tecnologia su cui io batterò tanto, perché comunque è il futuro, ma perché sta cambiando il mondo. Quindi tanti dispositivi connessi, le reti che devono funzionare e in ogni caso prestazioni in grado di rendere l'esperienza d'uso importante, perché ormai tra applicazioni che vanno su cloud, ma parliamo delle cose più semplici, dal termostato che avete a casa fino al sistema di videosorveglianza, arrivando al centralino telefonico, arrivando alla gestione dei client all'interno di un'azienda, c'è necessità che il Wi-Fi sia in grado di gestire tante connessioni simultanee. E questo è un po' l'obiettivo. La presentazione è stata molto tecnica, ma proprio per chi magari ha competenze tali da capire come funziona, però l'obiettivo è questo, cioè se non si fa questo salto, si fa fatica. Oggi vi racconterò anche nel pomeriggio il prossimo case study basato su questa tecnologia che faremo al campionato mondiale di rally in Sardegna, in cui useremo l'802.11ax, perché proprio l'anno scorso abbiamo avuto un problema come saturazione dei client. Allora, due cose. Sperando che appunto la temperatura dopo il coffee break ritorni a essere accettabile, e adesso farà una breve presentazione Amanda che racconterà agli altri colleghi non italiani tutto. C'è il coffee break, potete visitare i nostri stand in cui vi mostreremo la piattaforma cloud, i nuovi access point AX e potete vedere anche il nuovo supporto e poi i nostri partner. Io vi ringrazio, passo la parola ad Amanda e grazie e scusate per la temperatura. Ok.
So in a quick summary of what Simon presented on, AX technology is really bringing stronger connections and really future capabilities for your wireless networking. We really want to thank Qualcomm for their partnership over the years and really giving EnGenius the opportunity to be one of the first to market with the 2x2 access point. So we're continuing to lead the industry along with the innovation from Qualcomm. We're going to take a quick break for a coffee break, as well as giving you guys an opportunity to experience some of our new EnGenius solutions firsthand in the demo room next door. After that coffee break, we'll come back and we'll kick it off with our cloud presentation. Thank you. Antony Lai, who is our Vice President of EnGenius Networks. He will go over how to visualize your networks with our new network management solutions, which include cloud and NSky.
Good morning.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno. Hi, my name is Antony. I believe many people in the room already know that EnGenius have the networking management or the AP controller Easy Master. And I believe lots of people already use it. And the Easy Master actually is a networking management installed in your PC or server or in the Amazon AWS services. Okay? But today, we are going to announce the EnGenius Cloud. So it's my honor that I can introduce the EnGenius Cloud here in Milan. The reason why we choose Milan, because Milan is a city leading the future of fashion. So I believe that our EnGenius Cloud technology use lots of advanced technology that later on you will see and then you will experience together with me. And during the presentation, I will also do the live demo. Ooh, okay? All right, so what's EnGenius Cloud? It's not simply put the Easy Master up to cloud. Maybe you know that lots of vendors out there currently claim they sell the cloud vendor. Actually, they simply put their networking manager up to the cloud, up to the AWS, and say that they are cloud vendor. We don't do that. We use the most advanced cloud technology nowadays. Okay? Later on, I will elaborate about that. And we have brand new UI. Maybe some of you have already seen the screen, the UI out there in the demo room. And we have a brand new AI-driven features, which will be the second part of my seminar, of my presentation. And hopefully, and ask me to install here. All right, so I unboxing. And so to me, I'm a bridge of, they say plug and play, right? This is a factory default, all right? Plug and play.
Okay.
So this is our PoE switch, all right? So I just plug in the Ethernet ports and wait for the connection. Okay, so to prevent from cheating, let me do this. So what time is it?
RTSPG.
What?
RTSPG.
RTSPG, okay. Roger, please, RTSPG. All right, so what I'm doing right now is ask someone maybe out there 100,000 miles away, some people who is expert or may not be that expert to change something for me. So down here for me, I don't need any IT managers. I simply take one device and plug and it should play, right? So it requires some time to do the boot up and then to do the loading. So let me let you know that actually what we have done during the process. Okay, so how easy is this, is that it's very useful to manage many, many different remote offices. So the one thing that one big problem to deploy a multiple remote office is that you need to have a professional person, and to install, you might need to fly all over to do the on-site deployment. All right, because you need to go into this AP and do the local GUI and do all the configuration. So it will take lots of time and especially the resource. So what we do here, we simply ship the bus and then open up. So this is the cloud devices I'm doing right now. And this is the back of the cloud device. And then what I did is simply plug into a PoE switch. So what I did is that someone out there, he just created our cloud account and then registered this cloud device in the cloud. And once it registers and then put into one network, the network we are calling right now is a group configuration. All right, simply do three steps. For the branch office, as you can see that we just ship the box. Unbox it and then plug to the network. And it should work. All right, let me try to see. What's the SSID? Is it?
Hello.
Oh. Okay, so this is my screenshot of my mobile phone. So you can see there is a RTSPG, right? Working. So you can connect to this RTSPG. And I remember there must be some splash patch.
Yeah.
Right? Is it?
Yeah,
so you good. You can experience that. All right, here you go, the splash page. Good, thank you. And then the click connect to the internet. So everyone can do the same thing right now. So I didn't cheat on you, right? So it's simply just plug and play. It's very different from the previous experience that you have encountered. All right? Okay, then here comes another problem. Once it's installed, what happens if that you want to replace this device? What happens? Then you call your headquarters and ask them to ship another device to you? Wow, they will take days, right? So can I simply purchase locally? So I purchase locally a new device, a new cloud device. It can be Wi-Fi 5, it can be Wi-Fi 6, because the configuration should be the same, right? Okay, simply it's faster, all right? So we need to take a new technology. So it didn't register to our cloud. The cloud doesn't recognize it. So what should I do? Okay, back to my mobile phone. I have installed an app, the EnGenius Cloud app. Let me log in. So it asks me to choose one organization, which is the ABC Corporation at Milan. All right, and you can see that there is one device already in the inventory, which is the one I'm using right now, previously, and I just simply disconnected. And I want to add a new one, okay? So let me add this one. Simply scan the QR code on the back of the device and then register. So let me plug into the switch. Okay, registered already. Then I just mentioned that once you register, you need to assign to a network which got a different group configuration. Okay, so you need to assign this device to a network. The network is so this is the corporation. And I choose the inventory to see if it's already online. So the inventory, and then good, there are two devices. I just registered a new one. And this new one, you can have a prefix, so you don't need to type in every time. You just keep scan, and it will start with a Barcelo 2F, something like that. And then, so for this one, I see the detail, and then I want to add a button. I want to allocate it to one network, which is a group configuration, which is Milan event, and apply. So very simple, right? So you can see it down here, Milan event, already applied to this device. Okay, so the device is still booting up. So let me get back to my slide. Okay, so to replace this new device, it's a local purchased AP. So you don't want to ask someone to fly over. And you need to log into the local GUI and configure the setting. Then what will be the biggest problem? Even you are the professional. So when you replace one device, you need to reconfigure again. What will be the tough thing that you might encounter? Because you need to configure exactly the same as your previous one. So do you remember what you set for your previous AP? It's very hard. So you'd better back up the configuration. But here, for the cloud solution, you don't need to do that. You simply put this device into the network, and it simply works. All right, so, okay, so right now it should be ready already. So let's see. Okay, still need some time to finish the booting cycle. Okay, so for this one, if you want to replace the device, you simply need to scan, then plug and play. So this is the beauty of the cloud. And for the cloud access, you can go anywhere, anytime, and anyone, as long as they got the privilege, they can do the configuration. So after you deploy the devices, then after that you need to manage. The other big problem currently for your network is that all over the world, you install lots of AP, but you know that there are lots of different versions in each different AP. So it gives you a big problem that you need to manage so many versions of AP. What is worse? They said that you cannot upgrade from 1.2 directory to 2.1. You need to firstly upgrade to 1.8 and then 2.1. So give you lots of effort to do that. For cloud, you don't need to do that. We have the auto firmware upgrade function that no matter maybe this device putting in your warehouse for 3 months, and the current version could be version 1.2. Once you plug into the cloud, the first thing cloud doing is that it push the newest firmware to these devices, so you even doesn't know what it is. So for the firmware version, you don't need to care about it. So here we got the setting. You can force to upgrade right now, or you can schedule, please upgrade my AP on Sunday midnight. So you can set the upgrade window. And then once you set, you just leave it. Okay, so it's so simple to manage your firmware version. And then the other one is that I just created SSID, and maybe I created with WPA simply, but they said there are lots of issues with the WPA, so I had better change it to WPA to enterprise. So if I need to do that, simply I go to cloud and change it, and it will apply to all the AP across the world. So we can do the remote and group configuration. It doesn't matter where your device is located. And like most of the networking manager, we have the dashboard with the throughput, top end reports. We have the access point list. And then down here you can click, and then you can have a quick view of these devices, and then you can open lots of a small window to see at a glance that what's the difference between different AP. And we also provide a Google map. So here we put two AP down here and one building. This building got lots of many different layer of floor. So it will go to floor plan. Okay, so where you put other AP on. And we also provide a floor map with heat map. And the device detail page with the throughput and all the detail information. And the client list, that which client and what kind of OS is working on. and topology view. And also, we have the notification that you can set by network. So so you can say that if the AP goes offline for 5 minutes, not for me, I don't want to receive all the notification once the AP disconnected, because sometimes the internet is not that trustable. So it just disconnected and connected back. I don't want this kind of notification. So I can set like this. So for each different network group, I can set different rule. And then for each network, if there might be 10 or 100 users who needs to be notified, imagine that this is cloud. So I might have 10,000 devices or 10,000 networking out there, and times 10 users, then you need to notify 100,000 with different criteria. So with that, it requires some big data technology. So we actually leverage some new big data database to do that. And for those notification, we also can notify your mobile phone. Okay. And so till now, I believe many people will say that the cloud, everything goes cloud, especially in Europe. We protect the users' data seriously. Okay. So if everything goes cloud, so how you protect my user data? Okay, so for EnGenius Cloud solution, users' data won't go through EnGenius Cloud. It goes directly through the device to the internet. So we don't collect any of your transfer data. And what about that if, is it possible that someone emulate our device and connect to your cloud, trying to breach your network manage? We have a patent pending technology to prevent from that. So for every device, we have a public key. Once it connected to the cloud, you will negotiate with cloud and say that I'm a legal device. Please give me a private key. So we send a private key to this device, and then using this private key to build two-factor authentication secure tunnel. All right, so it's very secure that you cannot just simulate to trying to connect to the cloud. Some of the vendor actually they say they use HTTPS to do the encryption. But that's why we use the two-factor authentication to make sure that the device is a legal device. And then for maybe you have I'm not sure you have read our white paper, serverless. Rent some server, physical server, in Amazon or your local ISP. And then the newer technology to break down this server into smaller virtual machine. Okay, so the scale is smaller and then the more scalable. However, it's still within these servers. And then the newer technology is the Docker based. So they break down even smaller component of the VM into a smaller Docker. So you have more flexibility to do the scalability, okay? So this is the technology most of the cloud vendor nowadays using. So you can check with them, right? But we don't use them. Why is that? Because there is always a boundary of the server. It's still a server. Then someone needs to take care that, I need to transfer this user to a bigger Docker. So I create another Docker, although it's very easy to create. However, you still need to do the work. Okay, and then transfer all the data of the user into the Docker to make sure that the customer is comfortable. However, manually. So if you only count on human being, there will always some trouble with that. Okay, so, and then the big issue is that there is always a limitation of the number of the managed devices. One thing you can very easy to tell for those for other vendor to see their license statement. If they say that the maximum 800 units at one site or 500 units at one site, it means that they are using server base because there is a boundary. So you cannot you cannot exceed that boundary. So it's very easy to tell. So we think that it's not a true cloud concept. And then when the user reached the boundary of the device, the Docker or VM, the performance become very bad. Okay, so so why we know this? Because we have gone through that. 2 years ago, we have this server-based cloud infrastructure already established. And we ourselves, we found that it's not that scalable. It requires lots of manpower to monitor and do the adjustment. So we decided at that time that we need to rebuild the whole cloud using this serverless function as a service infrastructure. So we actually break this boundary of server and break into different function. We see this infrastructure different function. So for the devices it connect to one function. For the real time status, this is another function with lots of different server. And then some other server doing the configuration. So it's very scalable. So if right now there are lots of devices need to connect to the cloud, the function module who handling the connection of the AP will scale up. But it nothing to do with the database or nothing to do with other dashboard or something. So it's a very scalable using this kind of technology. Okay, so you can have a different scale of each function. So in that case, you can do a very scalable cloud deployment. This is why we call this is very highly scalable. And you will ask how scalable it is. So there are some vendor who challenge current cloud leader who is Meraki, Cisco Meraki, and they charge that your cloud infrastructure is not scalable. And then the Cisco Meraki jump out and said that in our customer install site, we already reach 29,000 devices at one site, which is very, very big to their concept. So what about our scalability? We test our system. And how we test? We simulate the AP using the server to simulate the AP, and then to connect, to send all the traffic, the data, the data. And then we have already tested up to 100,000 devices, one site, 100,000. I believe most of the customer cannot reach that number, and not to say other leading cloud vendor out there. So this is why we need to rebuild our cloud infrastructure using serverless technology. So this is our new technology using. So in that case,
our cloud actually can deliver a very secure and very scalable. So to sum up, we have deployed a plug and play, so you can easily deploy multiple sites of remote site. And then we have auto firmware upgrade. Then you can manage devices easily. And if there is anything policy changing, you simply go to cloud and then do the change. Very easy. And everything is built upon this secure cloud infrastructure. And you don't need to care about the how big it can handle. All right? So this is the first part of our cloud. If I stop here, I won't dare to stand here, because nothing very new, although we do have some inside technology, but that inside technology most of people cannot see, right? You cannot feel. If you cannot feel, then you are not moved by this technology. So I want to introduce our AI-driven EnGenius Cloud. AI-driven, wow, what a trendy term, right? So what is AI? Of course, artificial intelligence. I believe people will say machine learning, right? Okay, so what does it mean to you? Right, you build a robot, and in the end, a robot kill you, like a movie? No, this is not AI's purpose, all right? So to us, we think and we define this AI should bring a meaningful experience to the end user. Okay, so to take out all the hard to understand technology, and then let your user easily know that what he should do next. Okay, so this is an EnGenius Cloud that we would like our user be able to visualize their cloud and then get a good advisor. Just like a light beam, it's simply a white line. And then if they use EnGenius Cloud, we let you visualize your network in more detail. And then you will see a beautiful color out there. What's the beautiful color? We will advise you a meaningful advisor. For example, hey, your AP transmission power is too big, all right? So because it's too big, and then your client doesn't have the power to send back the message. So although he got a very good signal strength on his mobile phone, however, his data transfer is so low. So what's the advice? We will advise you that for your 5 gig, it's better that you configure it to like 15 to 17 dBm. Why is that? Because most of your mobile phone or the devices is about this range of transmission power. So it's better to pair with those clients, devices, to make sure that when you transmit, you receive the same, all right? Okay, so for this, like something like this, is more meaningful to the end user, because lots of people doesn't know that the current devices, what kind of transmission power they got. In the future, they will be maybe bigger or smaller, but you will keep following those. So we will do that for you. We will build it into our database and then advise you what should you do, right? So here could be the problem. I just show you lots of a dashboard in my first half of presentation. So this is one of it. So this is the list of managed devices. So what it tells you? Oh, okay, the channel, okay, the MAC address, that's it. All right, and we just saw that we can have a quick look of the dashboard, the device, the performance, the channel utilization, the percentage of channel utilization. What is channel utilization? If the channel utilization shows here saying that currently is like 65% of channel utilization, is it good? Is it bad? We don't know, right? So is that simple that we're just using that data and say that it's good or bad? No. There is throughput, all right? If the throughput is high, your channel utilization will be high. However, what's the relationship between them? We don't know, all right? Okay, so we have an AI-driven advisory. So besides this, when you mouse over to that, to here, and then we will compare the throughput and the channel utilization, and let you know that, oh, your channel utilization is relatively high. Do you want more advisor? Okay, yes, I want to see the advisory. So there might be some advisory board for you. So we will look into more information, saying that currently for this AP is a client, the client connected to it is already 52 clients connected to one AP. It could be too high for you. So we know that using this number, we will dig into more detail and bring in a meaningful meaningful message to you. And then let you know that what will be the potential issue and what you should do. So you may go to somewhere else and then limit the maximum number of your client, of the AP. So we have a redirection. You just click here, it bring you to that configuration, and then you can change the maximum number of clients. If we didn't advise you this, you never know that we can do this adjustment. All right, so there are other advisory board. So in that case, user can simply look at this and then got a better knowledge of his network. So this is what we call the AI-based advisory. The other thing is that about the dashboard, you just seen that you got the performance, the time, the top end, but what I need to know is that how good is my network, all right? So we have a network health center. We will do lots of measurement. So we'll come up with this radar chart and let you know, oh, there might be some issue detected. So you click here and then you do more investigation. And here is the how many devices connected to your switch. And we also see the client list here. So when someone call you and say that, oh, I got some problem, say this Anthony's iPad, Anthony call you that it just cannot connect to the Wi-Fi. And when you want, you of course you want to ask more information that, do you know which device you connect to, where you are, and lots of information. We have the client network timeline. Okay, so we provide you this information. So we click on this device, and then we will see this timeline. That means that what time this client doing what in your network? You will see the overview of it. So for this 18-inch iPad, this time it go to third floor and then connect to this AP, and then he moved down to second floor and lobby, and then connected successfully. However, later on, it just cannot connect it. So you don't need to ask your customer or your client to explain to you what happened. you know exactly, you know better than him. And then you can take the action, again, ask advisor, and then there will be more advisory for you to debug your network. And then, so in the previous case, it disconnected to the AP, right? So there will be, there might be some problems with the AP. So you go, you come to AP detail page, and this is what you see, right? Mostly, and you see the throughput, the time, and the IP address. What does it mean to you, right? So usually, when there's the hardware devices encounter some problem, what's the major thing you want to see? If a server kind of very slow, the first thing you want to see is what? You want to see the real-time CPU power and how's the memory utilization, but it's real-time. For cloud, if you want to build a real-time, it requires kind of different technology to do that, but we can do that already. So in that case, we can have a device real-time checker. Okay, so when you come to the device detail page, you will also see the real-time information of CPU utilization, the memory utilization, and throughput, everything here. Okay, so for you, you might think this is so normal. However, while you are doing the cloud manage, you can go out there to see how many vendors can do this real-time information for you. Okay. And floor plan, interesting. So when you see the floor plan here, and there are two AP and you see, wow, pretty good, the coverage is good. But this kind of information might mislead you because you think the coverage is so good, so you don't need to do anything. All right? But this is because it's lack of more information. So if you put all the walls here, obstacles here, then we can do the predictive floor plan. So you put the walls here, so the actual heat map is look like this. Okay, so actually you cannot cover the whole area. There are some blank spot here. So you better put another AP down here. So this is what our floor plan can do. So in that case, you put another AP here. But is this the best placement that you can put on the floor that can cover the best of your floor? You don't know, all right? You just visualize it and see, maybe I need to put in this place. In EnGenius Cloud, we can advise you, saying that. So we call it constantly floor plan. We will advise you that for those three devices, it's better you put like this, and then to see if you want to change or not. So at least it already calculate, and then they let you know which position is better to put your current existing devices. Furthermore, if I want to use someday, I already implement lots of IP4, so I need the whole coverage to be able to transfer VoIP traffic. Okay, so in that case, maybe I need to have every spot to be RSSI to be like a minus 65 at least, so you can do the voice over IP. So in that case, how many API should have? Again, we can advise you that under this VoIP environment, you need to have five AP and then put in like this and using different channels. So so to see if you want to change or not. All right. I believe most of you familiar with our Wi-Fi planner, Easy Wi-Fi planner. Actually, we leverage that technology into this cloud, and I believe lots of cloud vendors out there cannot do this, okay? Because they don't own this technology. All right, and this is very common. Like an MSP or maybe system integrator like you, you got lots of customers, and then you want to manage centrally. So how you can organize this in your network management? Some vendor doing tech. Okay, so they put lots of tech to each different AP. Okay, so if you want to see a company C, you simply type a company C, and then you have a list of AP using this company C. But with this tech, can you tell you the relationship like this? No, so it's ridiculous. How user can use this kind of tech? How he can remember those tags? So in our case, we do it the hierarchical interview. So by nature, when you build within your organization, you can have this kind of hierarchy, just like a fire manager. So easy, very straightforward. So you can create lots of different layer of hierarchy. Okay, so in this case, for company B, you have a US, Europe, and for company C, also have a US, Europe branch office, and then you can do it just like a fire manager every day you are using. I think it's much easier. Okay, so in summary that we got lots of AI-driven technology putting into here. The whole philosophy is that every day we are thinking that how we can help our user to manage their network easier without knowing that much networking technology. So this is our purpose. And we will keep doing this. And with the cloud, it's so good. It's a so good platform that we can keep enhancing. And once we enhance, we can update the customer immediately. So this is our AI-driven cloud technology. And then with this, so in summer, we will launch this cloud to the market. And then after that, we have some new products on the plan. Okay, so what will be it? Currently, we call this cloud AP. And then for the next phase, we will have a Cloud Pro AP. What is Cloud Pro AP? It got a dedicated scanning radio. All right, so this dedicated scanning radio, it doesn't interfere those AP you are working. But it scans the whole radio in the environment and see if there is a rogue AP coming up, or is there any non-Wi-Fi traffic coming up. So using this new hardware technology into our AP, we can do this zero weight DFS. Because especially in Europe, there are very few bands you can use. So it's better that you can leverage the DFS channel, so you got a better performance. However, there is some rule why you are using DFS. If we got this dedicated scanning radio, we can keep monitoring the other DFS channel. And then when the current channel I'm using have some problem that some DFS they want to use, then I can immediately transfer to the other available DFS channel. So in that case, you can just swim between those available DFS channel. So it will be very, very useful for you to increase your performance. And real-time and RF radio frequency status. So you can see the in real-time, the performance of the what happened to current radio, and then so you can find immediately what kind of rogue AP already emerging in your environment, and now you can take immediate action. And we also will build in the BOE 5.0, which is also very hot topic right now. They said that the BOE 5.0 will become de facto IoT standard because it's cheap and the transmission power is very minimal, and then the range is high, and it also supports the mesh. So it can very easily beat the current Zigbee or Z-Wave, those are technology. So they said that the BOE will be a next IoT protocol, very important. So we build this hardware into our next generation AP, and then with that you can easily do the location based marketing or something like that. Okay, so this is our next generation that we are going to launch also within this year. So hopefully in Q4 timeframe, we can release this new device. The hardware is already ready, and we simply need to implement those advanced features onto the cloud. All right, so in summary, the cloud family, okay, so we have the cloud platform, mobile app, the cloud switch, and cloud access point. So for the cloud access point, we will provide 2x2 AC and indoor and outdoor. Okay, wait a second. I thought our previous session talking about Wi-Fi 6. Don't you put it in? Here you go. So we will also announce the ECW220, which is a 2x2 AX managed by cloud. And it will be very likely the first 2x2 11X cloud AP. Okay? And by the way, I received lots of questions from the field that, hey, come on, it's so good product. What's your price? Please give us some time, all right? So, because our product is going to launch in summer, and before that, we will definitely let you know the price. But our current position is very clear. We want this product to be very competitive, to be very, very competitive, okay? So, please just wait for a moment, right? And for switch, besides these eight ports, we also will announce the 10G uplink switch devices. And you can see that this is cloud-enabled switch. So it's not necessary that it needs to connect to the cloud. That you can use it as a standalone, but by default, it will be managed by cloud. So with this, you can see the whole topology of your network. And besides that, we will provide full set of API. This is also not that easy, okay? But currently, we already have a full set of API that you can access our cloud, our switch, and our AP. If you found a big telco company and they said that they want their own UI, it's very easy because all the API is ready out there. So you can change your UI, you can do the application aware stuff or security or location-based services based on those API. Okay, so it's all ready. All right, so this is about our EnGenius Cloud. Hopefully you think this might be a good product and easy to use, and then which can boost your sales from this year on. Okay, so before I do the live demo, I will also do the live demo to let you see what our cloud is. I need to introduce our EnGenius end-to-end solution. Because besides this cloud-based solution, you all know that we also have the Easy Master, that if your user would like to use on-premises services instead of cloud, even our cloud is so secure and scalable, they cannot just trust anything in the cloud, then in that case, you still can choose the on-premises solution, which is the Easy Master. And we are going to announce SkyKey and the remote access portal. So altogether, we call this the N-Sky. This is cloud, this is sky, all right? So this is a SkyKey, small like this. So maybe you can see the device out there. You simply just put the Easy Master in these devices. So you've got the 2 gigabit port interfaces, and PoE is PoE, and can manage up to 50 devices, and 7 days of statistic data due to the hardware limitation. And you simply connect it to your switch. All right, so in the past, you need to find the server to install a VM and then install the Easy Master. Now you don't need to do that. You simply purchase this box. And then, what's the application? So for different sites, maybe for different customers, you just put the SkyKey or the Easy Master at a different site. And then, we will provide you the remote access portal. Look like this. So you access the N-Sky remote cloud portal, then you will see the list under your name, the list of Easy Master or SkyKey. So you can manage under one single pane of glasses. Okay, so you will see the list and what's the model, the MAC address, and if you want to go, you simply click this create tunnel. So for our cloud, we will create a tunnel to go through all the security gateway and then access your local SkyKey. So you can, it's just like a team viewer that you don't need your client to build a team viewer, but using this remote access portal, you can do the remote access just like a config, centrally config a local GUI. Okay, so together, when we launch this SkyKey, we will also provide this remote access portal for you to easily manage the very big scale of a network. All right, so that's my presentation. So do I have still some time? All right, 10 minutes, 5 minutes? All right, so because everyone wants to see the what is this cloud. Okay, so I look in this, let me, I'm sorry about this. All right, so this is the one that, let me refresh. So this organization is looking. So you can see the radar chart here. Okay, so let's see the IP list. I just registered 2 devices here. So what we see is here. And then if you want to config, so this is the manage, this is configuration. If you configure SSID, you simply click here and then change whatever name you want to do. Okay, so under this SSID, the association, if it's open, traffic shaping, the KP portal, enable click through or using our EnGenius Cloud AAA server. We also build a cloud AAA server so you can use the EnGenius authentication. All right, so the splash page, you just see that splash page. I can change the color. Okay. And then the the SSID scheduling, what time you want to want this SSID to be broadcast. Alright, so this is SSID and radio setting, and you can see that it automatically detects that this is the AP is located in the domain, so it can show you will leverage the Italy the channel regulatory to make sure that you cannot config outside of the regulation. Okay, so for the AP list, you have the map, the Google map. All right, so you will there's some Chinese. You can put the you can also put the floor plan down here. But it's better that let me change you to some currently working. Actually, these devices are installed physically and for a period of time. That so you can move around this and do the heat map here. So you should, let's see some dashboard here. You will see lots of information already. And we also have some layer 7 dashboard built-in. So you can see actually what kind of application travel through your networks, right? And so for the client, here are all the client lists that travel through. So we only show you those client who has ever visit this AP and all the application traffic analysis here. Okay, so so pretty much it's like that. We also collect lots of event log. Actually, for event log, we think that's very important for end user. So we will keep developing more technology based on this event log and provide more valuable information or valuable AI-based advisory to the end user.
How we can collect those event log from syslog server outside? Is it possible?
Yes. It is. Yeah, you can do that. Yeah, there's also lots of syslog analysis providers. They can do a better job doing the analysis. Yes, you can do that. All right. So pretty much, just let you quickly see this, and then during the break time, you can go next door and play around with this EnGenius Cloud. Okay, so that ends my presentation, and I wish that we do bring the meaningful product to you and to your customers. Okay, so thank you very much.
Come avete visto, finalmente abbiamo lanciato una nuova soluzione che leva un attimino l'asticella della piattaforma. C'è da fare attenzione, non è una soluzione che va a sostituire l'attuale piattaforma basata su EasyMaster, non è una soluzione che va magari in tutti i tipi di applicazione, ma è una nuova soluzione che permette di andare in alcuni mercati. È altamente performante, avete visto, si lavora a livello 7, si aggiungono un sacco di funzionalità, veramente semplice da utilizzare, rimane l'altra piattaforma per alcuni tipi di lavori, ma finalmente possiamo offrire una soluzione particolarmente performante, ma con un sacco di feature in più, in grado di competere con i mostri sacri del settore. Anche l'attuale piattaforma, EasyMaster, poi con Skype, SkyKey, che abbiamo visto prima di là, chiara con me, sia in formato poi virtual machine che fisico, sta avendo un sacco di aggiornamenti. Per chi non se ne è accorto, è uscito il social login, black and white list per SSID, è stata aggiunta anche la possibilità sulla rete isolata di aggiungere dei white list. Cosa vuol dire? Quando crea una rete con la layer of isolation, quindi dove ogni utente non si vede tra di loro, posso aggiungere adesso un dispositivo visibile da tutti. Qual è l'applicazione? Dal classico hotspot alla stampante per lo spazio di coworking o al riproduttore musicale. Adesso questo è possibile. E importante anche i vostri feedback, perché io spesso parlo con voi, mi incontro, aggiornamenti, funzionamento dei prodotti, però spesso tante nuove funzionalità arrivano proprio da suggerimenti da parte vostra. E noi dopo vi faremo vedere, per chi è di là e non l'ha visto prima, il funzionamento e quant'altro. Sappiate che stiamo già sistemando un nuovo listino con tutta la nuova gamma dei prodotti, stiamo sistemando appunto anche degli eventi un po' più commerciali riguardo al lancio sia del Wi-Fi 6 e sia della piattaforma cloud, in cui vi racconteremo dove va venduto, perché onestamente, noi siamo qua perché tutta questa roba qua la dobbiamo tramutare in soldi, perché dobbiamo venderla e quindi riuscire a fare un po' di business. Ecco, l'obiettivo sarà in un secondo step cominciare a raccontarvi quali sono le applicazioni e dove c'è domanda di questa tipologia di prodotti. E quello che vi posso dire è enorme, è enorme. Dopo pranzo, adesso faremo la pausa pranzo e vi ruberò qualche minuto con qualche slide per raccontarvi come sta cambiando il Wi-Fi. Perché come vi dicevo prima, un'oretta fa, quello che noi conoscevamo prima come applicazione è cambiata. Il Wi-Fi non lo usiamo più per noi, per guardarmi l'orario dei treni. Il Wi-Fi lo usa la mia lavatrice per aggiornarsi il firmware, per verificare che la seta di quella tal marca non si rovini. Ecco, stiamo andando in quella direzione lì. E praticamente la mia parte è finita. Amanda, if you want to say something? Se avete qualsiasi domanda, ci vediamo nella vostra.
So just to quickly summarize, so EnGenius' cloud solution is really bringing a truly scalable and serverless solution to our customers to keep up with the rapid demand for the scalability of networks. So with that, we want to invite you guys all to enjoy lunch and again experience the demo room where you can get your hands on the cloud solution and really experience that along with the EnSky solution. Thank you.